sample at a controlled rate and measure the changes in physical and chemical properties. So a typical TGA graph will look into and could be divided into four stages. First stage will be a physical moisture which is getting evaporated, and there will be a little drop in a mass or weight over a temperature range. Then that second phase, we have a different range based upon the performance of that particular material, and that is known as a workable section or workable range, during which material can be recycled. So if you are able to get a longer temperature range, material will be able to recover and recycle in a more positive way or in more quantity in subsequent cycles. Third portion is a crystal structure which breaks down and crystal moisture is lost at this stage. And fourth section is a portion where bentonite get there and is no longer able to operate as it required. So let us take some two case studies and let us try to understand how natural sodium and how sodium activated bentonite differs. So in left hand side TGA graph, you can see a portion where we have put at around 250 degree centigrade. When sample is put from 250 centigrade to 400 centigrade, the drop is very low. You can see in this particular section, the drop is very low. Whereas slowly keep on losing its mass, its weight up to 600 degree centigrade. And subsequently after 600 centigrade, it loses very quickly. Whereas when we compare TGA for activated sodium activated bentonite, during the first phase, whatever we had seen, there is a quite substantial drop up to 250 degree centigrade. Again, that drop continues very quickly between 250 degree centigrade to 400 centigrade. And from 400 centigrade to 600, the drop is very substantial. You can see that how quickly almost it loses from 99% roughly, 99.5% to 96.5% very quickly. When you compare the same thing for natural sodium, it will be a drop very marginal between maybe around 99.75 to 99%, 99.25%. So that is a very marginal drop. Whereas in case of activated sodium bentonite, the drop is substantial. So this indicates that the workable range in case of natural sodium bentonite is much higher. But again, this is a comparative study which indicates, but it doesn't validate the actual parameters which normally we are testing in our day-to-day production. So for that, next is a MBVA based method. What we do here, we check the MBV of a given sample at room temperature, and then we can calcinate the sample by heating this bentonite in a muffle furnace in controlled condition at 500 degree centigrade, 550 degree centigrade, and 600 degree centigrade. Why we have chosen 500, 550, 600? Based upon TGA, if you look at what temperature range, how the drop is happening, we have seen over here. So based on this, to quantify it further, we are now qualifying based on MBVA method. From this table, you can see that natural sodium bentonite, when we tested at 100 at room temperature without calcination, it had shown 374 MBV, whereas activated bentonite was showing MBV higher than natural sodium bentonite, 398. But as we calcinate or as we heated the sample bentonite at 550 and 600, the drop in MBV is substantial. So at 600 degrees centigrade, we can see the MBV of natural sodium is around 278, which is around 74% retention what we are seeing, whereas sodium activated bentonite had dropped from 398 to 62. That is only 15% is remaining as a MBV. So this drop is quite substantial. So does it mean that no, just MBV based testing will be suffice for qualifying? No, because end of the day, what we are checking is properties like
Hello.
Parameters of panels, then results could be differing. So it is very important for a foundry person to keep a standard of process, keep a standard equipment, and keep a standard sand also. Because even if you change from 63 FS number to say 55 FS number or 60 FS number, results could change. What we can see here, we got a GCS of around 1560 on a natural sodium bentonite, whereas activated had shown 1540, GSS 320 and 360. So on those parameters, we can see that no, natural sodium bentonite slightly lower or maybe equal with respect to properties. But when you talk about DCS and WTS, it shows the better performance over natural activated bentonite. Now, as a second stage of the testing, what we do, like what we have done for MBV, we will be doing the calcination of bentonite in the muffle furnace or by heating bentonite for 1 hour at 500 degrees centigrade, 550 degrees centigrade, and 600 degrees centigrade. 1 second. We are purposely showing at different temperature how it is showing, how the results are dropping. So we had seen in previous slide at room temperature, we were having almost close results with a natural sodium bentonite and activated sodium bentonite with respect to GCS and DSS, whereas little better results on DCS and WTS with a sodium natural sodium bentonite. But we repeat the test again. We can see how it is changing the scenario. You can see at 600 degrees centigrade, the WTS on natural sodium bentonite, which was earlier 0.39, it dropped down to 0.14. And in case of sodium activated bentonite, the WTS from 0.354, it dropped down to 0.09. So this is a substantial drop. And for individual parameters, whatever is drop is happening or whatever is percentage retention is happening, we measure over here. So in lower portion of the table, you can see the GCS percentage retention, GS percentage retention, DCS percentage retention. And when we compare in totality, you arrive at the thermal durability of that particular sample. So in totality, if you can see the thermal durability of natural sodium bentonite in with respect to the combination effect of GCS, it comes to a 86% at 500 degrees centigrade. It comes to 68% at 550 degrees centigrade, and at 600 degrees, 51% at 600 degrees centigrade. Is now recyclable. You can times to achieve the best parameters at room temperature, people increase the activation level of the bentonite and they try to achieve higher WTS. But when we do this kind of study, we observe that the thermal durability of bentonite, activated bentonite, get dropped from 34% to almost 27-28%. So that much drop happens. So that indicates that your bentonite on subsequent burning will create a problem. The addition rate required in subsequent cycles will be more. Is it clear, or you need any further explanation?
Yes, it is clear, sir.
Yeah.
If any questions, they will ask
later on. No problem. Now, at this stage, what we have to keep in mind that whatever study we have done, whether it is a TGA analysis or MDB or a thermal durability analysis, as we have shown, we are not considering many aspects of running contouring, like casting mix. When there is a change in casting mix, your metal grade will change, your pouring temperature will change, your sand to metal ratio will change, that will affect the burning ratio. Such cores which is getting into the system will also affect, it will change. For example, if you take a cold box core, the dilution will be very high, or shell core, it will be very high. But if you take a CO2 core or no-bake core, the core dilution will be very low. Similarly, shakeout time. So based upon the casting cooling time, how long you are keeping the casting in the mold will decide the burnout performance or burnout properties. For example, if you keep casting for 1 hour, returns and properties will be different. And same casting, if you cool it for 2 hours or 4 hours or overnight, whatever returns and will be coming back for next cycle will have a very negative impact, and it will be totally burned sand. Similarly, what kind of other facilities of sand cooler, hot sand you are having, how much sand is available in the system. So that will decide your number of rotations, how many times your sand is getting rotated in a given day. Similarly, the dust collection, impact of dust collection, quality and quantity. So if your extraction is good, very effective, good amount of bentonite which is available in the sand will get out of the system. And if we are not reusing it back in the system, the addition rate which are required in subsequent cycles will also go up. Similarly, Muller type and efficiency will also decide. For example, if your Muller condition is not up to the mark, or your addition rates on sand batch rate is maybe 70 or 80% of the actual capacity. So to achieve the required sand properties of GCS, GSS or WTS, naturally your additive additions goes up. So these parameters and their impact, we are not able to capture so far in lab test. There are ways and means also over there, but these different parameters we cannot study individually in a lab. So these are the things where we have to keep in back of our mind, and we should not say that my thermal, when I'm giving example, my thermal durability of the bentonite is 51%, but still my addition of the bentonite is going up. Why? So we need to also look into these kind of parameters, why it is going up, where things are going wrong. So coming back to a function of bentonite linked to silica sand expansion. So we have seen that TGA analysis of bentonite. Similarly, we are trying to correlate TGA analysis of bentonite with silica sand expansion. So as we know that silica sand expands at 573 degrees centigrade. And if you take a normal calcium or a normal calcium bentonite, it will burn, it will lose its mass very quickly, and it will not give in subsequent cycles, the addition rate required will be more. Whereas sodium bentonite, as we had seen, it absorbs the silica sand expansion. And to that extent, the related expansion related defects like scab, cattail will get controlled. This is one of the important part why to go for a natural sodium bentonite or sodium based bentonite. These are a different comparison between sodium bentonite and calcium bentonite. Based upon what we have seen so far, like thermal durability we have seen, swelling part we have seen, WTS part we have seen, how much is the water retention, what about GCS. These are the comparison what we have seen. Now, one will ask that how then we can compare with what is available in India. Okay, before that, these are the some comparison again of natural sodium bentonite and calcium bentonite from different perspective and different relative rankings for selection process. Now, these are what we are so far talking about is only on natural sodium and natural calcium. But if you look at it, some foundries in US or in Europe, they do the blending of natural sodium and natural calcium to get a best compromise between both of the properties. So in this chart, if you can see on the left-hand side, 100% sodium is there, and other side 100% calcium is there. And if you compare the green sand properties and dry sand properties, like green compression and dry compression properties, we can optimize the both the properties by doing the blending of either 75% of sodium with a 25% calcium, or 50% of sodium and 50% of calcium. We say true calcium or natural calcium. We are not talking about calcium or activated calcium here right now at this stage. So you can other side, you can see how the parameters are changing, properties are changing, and we are getting benefited, and we are able to optimize the both the properties, good parameter of green compression and dry compression by blending natural sodium and natural calcium. So when we are talking about soda activated calcium bentonite, this is one of the graph which is available. Study was done that the way we keep on doing the activation, how the performance is getting affected. And that is also again supported by the study like what we have shown to you with the thermal durability. Higher the activation level we try to do to achieve room temperature properties for acceptance of the bentonite, high temperature properties of these bentonite get affected. WTS drops down at elevated temperature, hot sand properties drops down at elevated temperature. So, here again, the sand property interaction between the different parameters. So everywhere here, we can again see that clay or a bentonite plays a major role, and almost all parameters which we are doing as a testing on day-to-day basis to control the sand properties get affected and get controlled by bentonite. When we are talking about bentonite or Indian context, as a summary, what we can recommend is that we can go with a natural sodium bentonite or calcium or natural activated calcium bentonite by using 20 to 30% of natural sodium bentonite along with 80 to 65% soda activated calcium bentonite, what is available in India. And as a blend, as a combination of these two, we can get benefited in terms of reduced additive consumption of bentonite, coal, new sand consumption, improve casting peel off, reduce sand inclusion, pinhole, blowhole defect, in mold decay. Part what we wanted to talk about. If you have any further questions, you can connect to our team, to me, Mr. Patrick, anytime. We can move for the next question answer session. Sandeep Kulkarni, sir.
Yes, thank you, Ashutosh. Thank you very much. It's a nice presentation. Lot of practical thought process has been shown here.
I'm sorry, there was in between some disturbance. I was unable to rectify on my own way here. Sorry for that. Yeah. You can unmute, sir, or how?
Yes, any questions? Any questions? You can put it on chat box as well. Ashutosh, I think you are the host, so you have to unmute the people.
Okay.
Yeah. I think Shashi Suman is asking for unmuting. Then Ravi Galaxy is asking for unmuting.
One second. For unmuting, where I have to go?
In the participants, you can go and unmute him. Shitosh, I have a question. How scabbing is related to this parameter, sodium bentonite, calcium bentonite, and thermal durability? What is the relation between the scabbing and all these things?
Can you ask again, sir, question?
Yeah, what is the relation of scabbing with all these things, that is the calcium bentonite or sodium bentonite, or blending of the two bentonites, or thermal durability?
Okay. Yeah. When we talk about any expansion scab,
yes,
two or three aspects to it. One, what I have shown, whenever sand grain get expanded at 573 degrees centigrade, if there is no space available surrounding, bentonite get burned out before it get expanded, there will be a problem. When there are two sand grains which are bonded with the bentonite, but bentonite is getting burned out before 573 degrees centigrade and sand expands, so there is no coverage, or there is no cushioning effect. Correct. So in case of natural sodium bentonite, since the burnout tendency is above 600 degrees centigrade, it can compensate for the expansion. It can allow sand to expand without distorting and getting close to each other. So that cushioning effect, as I have shown in the pictorial view, it gives a benefit. That is one thing. Second thing is the WTS. natural sodium bentonite, as we had seen that now, natural sodium bentonite compared to calcium or even to activated sodium bentonite is give, it gives at a very high temperature also continuously. So why scab or kind of defect are happening? Because moisture get affected because of heat, and moisture get transferred to subsequent layers very quickly. When this happens very quickly and water retention tendency is not getting retarded, then the at one particular stage, one layer become dry and another layer become too wet, and the bond between the dry layer and wet layer get disconnected, and you see the fall of sand as a scab defect. Whereas in case of sodium, because of retention of water is good, and the tendency of water evaporation or changeover from a layer to next layer is getting retarded, the tendency of scab comes down. So these are the two major aspects which are differentiating between natural sodium bentonite and any activated bentonite.
In case of Indian bentonite, there is calcium bentonite, WTS is always on the lower side, or there are some ores, or there are some kind of bentonite which also gives better WTS.
See, generally what we are seeing, people are able to add some additives, but again those additives, no, that you cannot add as a bentonite. Correct. In that same proportion, you are not able to add it. It is just additive which are added in a small proportion to enhance the tensile property. And these wet tensile properties, again, what we are seeing is at room temperature at 300 degrees centigrade. Okay, when we check the wet tensile, it is checked at 300 degrees centigrade. Now, if you compare the wet tensile at 600 degrees centigrade by increasing heating, probably wet tensile of sodium bentonite could be different. See, two different things I'm just trying to explain. Wet tensile, when you are checking at room temperature, we heat the sample, 2x2 sample. We raise the temperature to 300 degrees centigrade. And then we put the pool. And because of moisture get driven out at particular stage, there is a dry zone and a wet zone. Correct? And it gives you the reading of WTS. But it is checked at 300 degrees centigrade. But your entire sand is not at 300 degrees centigrade. The temperature of sand is varying even up to 800 degrees centigrade. So at this higher elevated temperature, what would be the wet tensile of a given bentonite is not tested. Okay. So that what we are trying to do it by doing thermal durability. And in the study or comparative what we have shown, it is seen that natural sodium bentonite shows higher thermal durability at 500 degrees centigrade, 500 degrees centigrade, or 600 degrees centigrade, as compared to activated bentonite at 500 centigrade, 550 or 600 degrees centigrade.
We check GCS as well as WTS. So, which is the competent, or we can say reliable test for testing the sand, especially for avoiding the sand defects?
There are two, three, again, what happens, sir, when you're checking all these parameters, WTS, GCS, all are done by 2x2 sampling, correct, in the lab, and a 3-RAM method. Whereas the parameter, actual machine parameter or actual production parameter could be different. For example, your sand flowability at a machine stage could be different than a lab compatibility, or actual compatibility at machine stage, molding stage could be different than actually what you are doing the testing in the lab. Correct. Then accordingly, your sand flowability will be different. Similarly, if your pattern is deep drawn pattern, the parameters will be different. So you cannot always compare, okay, these are good guidelines when we are checking GCS compatibility, what are we are doing in the lab, are good guidelines to control. But at the same time, when there are some certain issues happening repeatedly, like, you know, some defects are coming repeatedly, we also need to see other parameters beyond what we do on routine basis. So, Deshpande sir, yes, you want to ask something?
You can unmute, I think. You can just check.
I unmuted him. He's unmuted.
Okay.
Sir, can you please tell me or elaborate on deep drawn pattern and scabbing?
Yes. When we are having a deep drawn pattern, what happens when you are having a compatibility, let us assume that now you are having a compatibility. Okay, so reasonably free flowing sign, correct? When you are having a normal pattern, not very deep, the compaction in that area will be very good. But in deep drawn pattern, the compaction of the mold or sand getting compacted may not be sufficient enough. Okay. So you will be having loose portion at the top surface or a deep pocket area. It may not be getting fully compacted. And when you pour such molds, the moisture driven out will be very quick as compared to well compacted mold. That will result into a particularly defect like scab. I will give example. If you are having a break drum casting, which is deep drawn break drum, you will see the tendency of scab sometimes on top surface in a cope half if it is self-cored item. Being a self-core atom, whereas a deep break drum which is not so deep, you may not be able to see similar kind of scab with same sand background. Okay, so these are difference typically what we can see the parameter. It is also linked to your pattern. It is also linked to your machine capability. How well compacted these deep drawn mold are. If it's a well-compacted mold always, then you may not be able to see such kind of scab very easily. But this kind of scab we can eliminate by using natural sodium bentonite in some proportion so that the tendency of water getting driven out get retarded. Yes.
Yes. Any more question? I think one more question we can take. Another 3 minutes left. So you can take one more question if anybody have. I think Deshpande sir have left, unfortunately.
I have unmuted him actually. I don't know.
Yes. Anybody have any questions? Okay, sir. Thank you, Ashutosh. Thank you very much for your nice presentation and good question answer session as well, interactive one. So hope people have understand this aspect of bentonite, sodium bentonite, calcium bentonite, blending and thermal durability and everything. So they will be benefited from this presentation as well. So thank you very much. We'll be putting this presentation on YouTube as well in the late evening today, so people who have missed it or they want to check it again, they can go back and see it anytime. Thank you once again for this second session from our series of sand. We'll have a third session next month, maybe on second week of June. So definitely we'll be looking forward to that as well. Thank you again, Ashutosh, and all MCOL team, entire MCOL team as well.
Thank you very much to all. Thanks.
Thank you. And everybody take care of yourself and your family. We have to take additional and special care to come out of this corona virus as well. So be safe and be, we can say, proactive as well. Thank you once again and have a nice time. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.